adverse employment action against an employee, with the burden then shifting to the employee to prove that the asserted reason was a pretext for discrimination. Assuming the employee cannot demonstrate that the employer's assertion of workplace safety was pretextual, the employer would prevail against an employment discrimination claim. How extraordinarily comforting. So if the employee wants to wear dreadlocks, and an employer is legitimately concerned for the health and safety of the employee that his scalp might be ripped off by a machine, then the employer can enter into the litigation. And it certainly couldn't be arbitrated. We took care of that yesterday, right on the floor of the House. We got to have litigation. We'll have expensive lawyers. We'll start, get the complaint filed, the answer filed. Maybe there'll be a motion to dismiss that'll be denied. We'll get into the discovery process. We'll send out the interrogatories and the document requests. We'll ask for the other occasions where somebody's been fired, examine the process and the practices of the employer for the last decade. We'll get some experts in. We've got to have some experts to come in and testify the likelihood that the long dreadlocks are going to get caught in the machinery. We'll have conflicting experts, each on each side. They'll disagree. And then the court will receive a motion for summary judgment, say, is there enough evidence to submit the case to trial? And the court will go, the judge will have a 130-page opinion that'll examine the burden-shifting scheme and the initial burden and then the response burden, and the burden shifts to the employee to show pretext. And the inflation rate creeps higher, and the folks willing to enter into jobs seem to be less and less, and the catastrophes keep coming. But this is the top priority. I don't think we need to drive lawsuits between Americans. I think in the main, Americans well understand the rules of the road. As the Judiciary Committee itself reports, courts have generally even recognized that hairstyle, to the extent it's associated with race, as a basis for decisions on employment or the like, is already unlawful. The EEOC's own manual says that discriminating on the basis of, for example, afros is unlawful. Another solution to a problem that doesn't exist in any significant scope in this country, and the result being inflation that gets higher, more supply constriction that drives inflation higher, more animosity and obstacles between employees and employers, between merchants and customers, to drive more lawsuits, to pay more lawyers, to make the quality of life in America so much better. That's where we are. That's where we are today on the floor of the House. I yield back.
The gentleman from Ohio reserves. The gentleman from New York, Mr. Nadler, is recognized.
Madam Speaker, I would point out again, because some of my Republican colleagues seem not to hear it, that this is the law, as they say, but that several circuit courts say it isn't the law. So all this bill is doing is reaffirming what the law is, despite several circuit courts. And we see that the law in those states where the circuit courts have upheld it properly has not resulted in any of the catastrophes we just heard. Madam Speaker, I now yield to...
Neil?
Yes, I will.
Is it not correct, Mr. Chairman, the reason this bill is on the floor is because Republicans voted against a suspension?
Yes.
Which could have easily passed to say we're against discrimination. And because 188 Republicans voted no, this bill needed to come forward. Because, as the chairman has just pointed out, the law is in doubt because courts have taken different positions. I thank the chairman for yielding.
I thank the gentleman. I now yield 2 minutes to the gentlelady from California, Ms. Lee.
The
Thank you, Madam Speaker. I rise in strong support of H.R. 2116, the Creating a Respectful and Open World for Natural Hair Act, commonly known as the Crown Act. And I'd like to thank Speaker Pelosi, Chairman Nadler, and of course, Congresswoman Bonnie Watson Coleman for bringing this bill to the floor. And let me just first say, we all know, and you've heard the debate, that this bill is going to take aim at prohibiting race-based hair discrimination. But let me just tell the other side, I am an American, and it is very important to me and to millions of Americans. Yet, you know, your arguments, you know, they're outrageous, but they're not surprising that Republicans, every step of the way, try to diminish the humanity of black and brown people, try to uphold white supremacy at every step of the way. Just listen to what you're saying in terms of arguing against this bill. For decades, black and brown people have been penalized for wearing hairstyles, natural hairstyles, deemed as messy, unruly, and unprofessional. We've seen students humiliated and unfairly disciplined because their braided hair extensions or locks were considered a violation of the dress code. In the workplace, black people with curly afros, braids, twists, or locks, or with no hair, are often perceived as less professional than people with straightened hair, which negatively impacts their ability to be promoted or to get raises. And yes, personally, I've always worn my hair however I chose. I've worn it straight, I've worn it braided, I've worn it spiked, I've worn it curly, I've worn it in a big natural, you name it, you name it. Everyone should be able to make those choices without fear of repercussion. Hair discrimination is rooted in systemic racism and is a real barrier to advancement and empowerment for our communities. Now, I've been fighting to end this discriminatory practice for years. In 2014, the women of the Congressional Black Caucus urged the Army to rescind Army Regulation 671, which prohibited many hairstyles worn by African-American women and other women of color.
Gentlelady's
and I led an amendment in the fiscal year 15 Defense Appropriations Bill to ban funding for this discriminatory
group. Gentlelady will suspend.
May I have another 30 seconds? Mr. Chairman?
I yield the gentlelady another 30 seconds.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just want to remind you, we put this in the Defense Appropriations Bill to ban funding for this discriminatory rule. The military understood it. And due to our advocacy, a few years later, the U.S. Navy removed their discriminatory policy, allowing women, especially women of color, to wear their hair in dreadlocks, large buns, braids, and ponytails. We owe it to ourselves and to future generations to take action here in Congress to break down these barriers. Everyone should be able to show up as their authentic selves, and passing the Crown Act is a major step in that direction. I urge my colleagues to vote yes, and I yield back.
The gentleman from New York reserves. The gentleman from Ohio, Mr. Jordan, is recognized.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. I just want to point out the majority leader just 3 minutes ago said the reason the bill is on the floor today is because of the minority. That can't happen. We don't schedule the floor. The reason the bill's on the floor today is because the majority's bringing it to the floor. I mean, I would love to be able to have the power as a minority to bring legislation to the floor, because if we could, I tell you what, it wouldn't be this bill. It'd be a bill dealing with energy, a bill trying to bring down the price of gasoline, which is at $5 a gallon in some states. It'd be a bill trying to deal with the border situation. I wish we could schedule the floor. Now, let's hope the American people are going to make a change this fall and put us in a position where we can schedule the floor, because if we do, if we get that power, we will focus on those kind of issues. The majority leader of the House of Representatives just said the reason the bill's on the floor today is because of the minority. That cannot happen. I wish it could, but it can't. Those are the kind of arguments we're getting. We should be focused on the issues the American people want us to focus on right now. Families across this country, all families want us to focus on certain things, but not the Democrats. They're going to focus on the hair bill. They're going to focus. I would yield to the gentleman from North Carolina.
The gentleman from North Carolina, for how much time, sir?
As much time as he wants.
The gentleman is recognized.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. Mr. Jordan, to the point just made, it does strike me that what is being described even by the majority leader or by the chairman of the Judiciary Committee is that some courts in the hundreds of federal courts that we have I'm not even sure they're all federal that they're describing, but I assume so, decided that this is not an issue that's covered or under one of the more of these laws. But you know what usually happens is the Congress waits for the court system to work this out to the United States Supreme Court, and when there's a decision there, if the decision is contrary to the intent of Congress, Congress responds. So again, in terms of picking up something that's unnecessary, that's what the majority is doing. It's not Republicans who bring the bill to the floor. It's not Republicans who pick a fight over something that most wouldn't even disagree about, except in circumstances of safety. And then the question becomes one of the degree of burden imposed on employers, whether you want to drive lawsuits. As you said, I was thinking as Mr. Jordan was speaking that it would be nice to bring, since we have, the minority can get issues to the floor. I didn't know that. I've been here just since 2019. We've been in the minority the whole time. And boy, I can think of a lot of things we could bring to the floor. We should bring a bill to unleash American energy independence. We really need that right now. Not just a bill cutting off imports from Russia. Not just a bill driving prices higher so that Americans will not only be paying $4 and $5 thanks to Joe Biden at the pump, but they'll soon be paying $6, $7, $8 at the pump. We could bring a bill to the floor, if the minority could do it, we could bring a bill to the floor that would say, let's open up the ability to drill. Let's encourage the energy industry in America to produce the energy that the world needs so that prices will be low and that Americans across the board, not just a few who want to, who have these extraneous handful of cases out of the whole federal court system in which the result has not turned out the way we would like it to have turned out. Let's worry about millions and millions of Americans who have to pay $7 or $8 at the pump every day soon. $5, $4, $5 now. That would be what I would do if the minority could bring something to the floor. With that, I yield back, Mr. Jordan.
The gentleman from Ohio reserves. The gentleman from New York is recognized.
Madam Speaker, I just want to point out that we don't need new drilling legislation. There are 6,000 leases which have been granted by the federal government, which the oil companies are not drilling. They can drill. I now yield 2 minutes to the distinguished gentleman from Tennessee, a member of the Judiciary Committee, Mr. Cohen.
The gentleman is recognized.
Thank you, Madam Speaker, and thank you, Mr. Nadler. I rise in strong support of H.R. 2116, the Crown Act. No one should be deprived of equal rights under the law because of the hair texture or style. It should never be the case that a person is denied the opportunity to participate in school sports or sent home from work just because of what their hair looks like. The most egregious example of this was a wrestling coach who had an African-American wrestler, have to cut his hair to perform. He wasn't allowed on the wrestling team unless his hair was cut because the wrestling coach didn't like it. Well, the wrestling coach was ignorant of the fact that that should have been his choice. He couldn't rise to understand it. Now, Mr. Bishop and I, we share something in common. We both don't have a wonderful crown with glorious locks. And sometimes when people, particularly people who aren't too smart, get mad at me, and I imagine Mr. Bishop too, they'll say, you bald-headed whatever. Well, I have no choice in the fact that I'm bald-headed. I had a lot of hair when I was young. I had more hair than Jordan. And no, sir. Well, I'll yield to you, Mr. Bishop.
I just asked, do you think anyone's ever discriminated against you because you're bald?
Well, they've said nasty things and thought it was nasty, and it's not nasty because I have no choice in the fact that I'm
bald. Did you bring a lawsuit?
And I'm just as good a human being and just as smart and just as effective and just as caring with or without hair. And the fact is, it's discrimination and it's ignorance. And African Americans have been discriminated against in many ways because of their hairstyle. It's a natural thing for African Americans, and they should not be penalized in their workplace, in sports, in school, or in any other ways. So I stand here for the Crown Act. It was originally introduced, I think, by Cedric Richmond. And I joined with him on the Judiciary Committee to support it. I'd seen problems in Tennessee when I was a state senator and supported bills there to protect people who wore braids and whatever. So I hope that people will rise up, vote yes, and understanding of other people and think beyond themselves. I yield back the balance of my time.
The gentleman's time has expired. The gentleman reserves. The gentleman from Ohio is recognized.
Reserve.
The gentleman reserves. The gentleman from New York is recognized.
Madam Speaker, I now yield two minutes to the gentlelady from Wisconsin, Ms. Moore.
The gentlelady is recognized.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Madam Speaker. Just let me say that unfortunately, I've never taken psychology during my college preparation, but I do know certain things, what avoidance behavior is. I tell you, the message discipline on that side is just perfect. You could talk about the southern border and inflation and all of that to avoid a very, very, the topic of discrimination. Sit down. I have the floor, sir. You're avoiding the fact, and I know personally as a person with my hair, that I have had people tell my employer that I was an embarrassment sitting in the front office because of the way my hair looked. And so to avoid a deep conversation about discrimination that has an impact, particularly on African Americans, you talk about everything else. It's wrong, you're not engaging, and quite frankly, you're not being honest. And I would yield back.
Members to direct all remarks to the chair. The gentleman from New York.
No,
the gentleman
us.
From Ohio reserves.
I would just thank you, Madam Speaker. Avoiding sounds to me like the Democrats are avoiding the issues the American people care about. That's our point. I'm focused on what the families in the 4th District of Ohio come to me and talk to me about. They are talking to me about $5 gas. Guarantee it. My guess is it's the same in all your districts as well. They are talking to me about the border, our southern border, that has been complete chaos now for 14 months. They're definitely talking to me about, they're talking to me about the price of eggs and milk and butter and food at the grocery, about everything, because we're at a 40-year high inflation. They are talking, avoidance? The people who are avoiding the issues the American people care about are on that side. And to get lectured by you and using that is so wrong, so out of touch with the American people. Avoiding, you gotta be kidding me. We wanna focus on the issues the American people care about. That's the whole darn point. Be happy to yield to my friend from North Carolina for as much time as he'd use.
Gentleman from North Carolina is recognized.
It's not a question of avoidance, it's a question of priority. Here's a priority. In 2020, homicides across America increased 30%, from 16,005 roughly to 21,005, an additional 5,000 homicides. And even if you want to view it through a racial lens, since that seems to be the subject, 55% of homicides are suffered by Black Americans, even though they make up 13% of the population. Of the increase I just described, Black Americans suffer 65%. So we could have, if the minority were capable of bringing a bill to the floor, we could bring a bill that would address the rising crime in America. The historically exceptional, historically unprecedented, I believe, at least I saw something since maybe the 1900 or 1902. I don't know what the circumstances were then. But since then, the highest increase of homicides in a single year in the history of the United States, grossly disproportionately borne by Black Americans, driven by rhetoric about defunding police. We could prioritize that. That wouldn't be avoidance, and yet we do not, because indeed we are in the minority, and the priorities are being set not by the minority but the majority. I yield back.
Gentleman from Ohio
reserves.
Gentleman from New York is recognized.
Madam Speaker, I now yield 2 minutes to the distinguished gentleman from Texas, Mr. Green.
Gentleman from Texas is recognized for 2 minutes.
And still I rise, Madam Speaker. And I rise today reminded that Dr. King addressed this very issue decades ago. He addressed it when he shared his poem with us. Fleecy locks and black complexion cannot forfeit nature's claim. Though skin may differ, affection dwells in black and white the same. And were I so tall as to reach the pole or to grasp the ocean at a span, I must be measured by my soul because the mind is the standard of the man and woman. I have lived long enough now at 74 years to have seen a time when black people would bleach their skin. The product was called Bleach and Glow, so that they could be as white as they could get. I've lived long enough to see them process their hair so that they could make it as straight as they could get it. I've lived long enough now, however, to see black people having decided that they're going to be themselves, they're going to wear their hair as they choose, and they're not going to allow themselves to be discriminated against it because of it. I've lived long enough now to understand that it's not the color of skin or the texture of hair. It's the character within that determines the worth of men and women. I've lived long enough to understand that black people are American people too. And when you say the American people don't want it, you cannot exclude black people. Black people would have this be on the floor. This is a kitchen table issue in black households. Because when Johnny comes home and he's been fired because of his hair, that's a kitchen table issue. That's unemployment. That impacts unemployment. So we have a duty and obligation to do what we're doing, and I will yield back the balance of my time with the understanding that we're going to be ourselves.
Gentleman from New York reserves.
Reserve.
Gentleman from Ohio is recognized.
We reserve, Madam Speaker.
Gentleman from Ohio reserves. Gentleman from New York is recognized.
Madam Speaker, I now yield 2 minutes to the gentlelady from Massachusetts, Ms. Presley.
Gentlelady from Massachusetts is recognized for 2 minutes.
Thank you to my distinguished colleague, House Judiciary Committee Chairman Nadler. I rise today on the floor of the House of Representatives, the People's House, to declare that black girls with our braids, locks, afros, all forms of natural hairstyles, and yes, even our smooth alopecian bald heads belong everywhere. Today, we take an important step towards codifying this fact into law by passing the Crown Act legislation. I'm so proud to co-lead in partnership with Representatives Watson, Coleman, Moore, Lee, and Omar. For too long, black girls have been discriminated against and criminalized for the hair that grows on our heads and the way we move through and show up in this world. In my home state, the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, two twin sisters, Deanna and Maya, high school students, were disciplined for showing up with braids. They were given numerous detentions, kicked off the track team, banned from prom solely for their hairstyle. In their own words, these scholars and athletes were judged more for their heritage than their homework. No more. For those sisters and thousands of other students who face discrimination based on their hair, the Crown Act is for you. For recent graduates who fear they must change their hair or cut their locks to secure a job, the Crown Act is for you. For our elders who have faced and fought this racism for generations, the Crown Act is for you. Just yesterday, the Massachusetts State Legislature made history by passing similar legislation. By passing the Crown Act today, we affirm, say it loud, black is beautiful and so is our hair. Whether you are a student in a classroom, an employee in the workplace, or the next Supreme Court justice or the Speaker pro tem, you deserve to show up as your full self, rocking your crown with your head held high. I urge a yes vote for every person who has been asked to shrink or to apologize simply for the beautiful way with which God made them. I yield back.
Gentlemen from New York reserves. Gentleman from Ohio is recognized.
Yeah, Madam Speaker, we reserve.
Gentleman from Ohio reserves. Gentleman from New York is recognized.
Madam Speaker, I now yield 3 minutes to the distinguished gentlelady from Texas, a member of the Judiciary Committee, Ms. Jackson Lee.
Ms. Jackson Lee from Texas is recognized for 3 minutes.
So many years ago,
with a bush as big as a bush on my head, an afro, of which I was enormously proud. Young, fragile ego, probably not that strong in my frame. Someone would say skinny legs and high heels. An early teen, trying to express the pain that I felt, living in a segregated world, but trying to assert the prominence of my community, my race of people, trying to associate belatedly with the foot soldiers and the battering and the insults that they received, trying to come to grips with the assassination of Dr. Martin Luther King, Bobby Kennedy, Malcolm X. I wore this bush, which I had to do extreme things for. The original style, as was done to young girls, is processed. It burned beyond recognition. And I went out with my grandmother, a woman of tradition, and fearful for me, she asked me to go back because she couldn't walk with me with an afro. The reason, of course, was her fear, what an afro signified, what it would do, how I would be harmed. Those were the conflicts and strife that black people went through, trying to come to grips with their identity. My good friend, Mr. Jordan, we never encounter each other because we have mutual respect, as I do for you and you do for Sheila Jackson Lee. We don't really get into it because we know we're the kind of folk that stand down from each other. But I enjoy engaging with you. I enjoy your leadership. And your constituents have every right to be concerned about gas prices. My constituents are concerned about eating, being able to pay their rent. And I believe we can walk and chew gum at the same time. Let's get together about gas prices and paying rent and people eating and having jobs and ending discrimination. Why can't we do that together? Because you have not walked in my skin. You've got to understand what it means when we are talking about a report that has been given in 2019, the Joy Collective, the Crown Act Coalition, disproportionately burdened by policies black people are and practices in public places, including the workplace, that target, profile, or single them out for their natural hairstyles. The Crown study found that black women's hair is more policed in the workplace.
His time has expired.
Gentlelady, an additional 30 seconds.
Gentlelady is recognized for
thereby contributing to the climate of group control. Black women are more likely to receive formal grooming policies. And 80% of black women believe that they had to change their hair to be in the workplace. Just imagine the beauty of these hairstyles. Mr. Jordan, the beauty of these hairstyles. This is what we're talking about. People who are severely discriminated against. Young boys, young girls. A little girl in a Catholic school could not wear her hair, had to go home. Or the fabulous Serena, who gives joy to all of us, and yet these are the locks that she is wearing. Can I get another 15? I thank you for recognizing.
I grant the gentlelady an additional 15 seconds.
I thank you, the chairman, very much. And this young boy, who like me, was felt diminished because someone thought it was wrong for me, an afro for him, his braided hair. Mr. Jordan, we have engaged in a lot, but I will not stand down on the Crown Act. We must pass the Crown Act to give dignity and reaffirm the rights of all people. Wear your hair as you desire.
Gentleman from Ohio is recognized.
Madam Speaker, we reserve.
From Ohio reserves.
Madam Speaker, I now yield 2 minutes.
The gentleman from New York is recognized.
Excuse me. I now yield 2 minutes to the gentlelady from Georgia, Ms. Williams.
Where's she from? Washington? Oh, Gentlelady from Georgia is recognized for 2 minutes.
Madam Speaker, I rise today in support of the Crown Act because all here is professional here. While serving in the Georgia State Senate, a colleague greeted me with what she thought was a compliment. After spending most of the legislative session in braids, I had my natural hair pressed straight. She told me, "Nikema, you should keep your hair that way. It looks better, more professional, more like a state senator." Remarks like this are all too familiar for Black women and girls, unacceptable on their own, but the outright discrimination that flows from them is worse. If I didn't work for the people in Congress, I know that I could be fired simply for wearing my hair in braids. Nothing about this is okay. So I make it a point to create an environment where my team feels comfortable wearing their crowns in every texture. Everybody deserves this level of safety, no matter where they work. Our hair is an expression of our authentic selves. Braids, locks, coils, or a silk press, all hair is professional hair. Discrimination has no place in America. That includes discriminating against Black hair. The Crown Act would make race-based hair discrimination a thing of the past once and for all, and that's why we should pass it today. Thank you, Madam Speaker, and I yield back.
Gentleman from New York reserves.
Madam Speaker,
gentleman from Ohio is recognized.
Yeah, Madam Speaker, we reserve.
Gentleman from Ohio reserves. Gentleman from New York is recognized.
Madam Speaker, we're prepared to close.
Gentleman reserves. Gentleman from Ohio is recognized.
Madam Speaker, for all the reasons we've talked about and what we should be focused on here, I would urge a no vote on the legislation, and I hope my colleagues will do the same. And with that, we yield back the balance of our time.
Gentleman yields back. All time has expired. Gentleman from New York is recognized.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. Madam Speaker, while racism and discrimination sometimes appear in overt forms, they can also manifest themselves in more subtle ways. One way is through discrimination based on natural hairstyles and hair textures associated with people of a particular race or national origin. This Crown Act would make explicit that the civil rights laws prohibit such discrimination. This is a matter of basic fairness and justice. This bill passed the House last Congress unanimously, and I hope we will do so again today. All the arguments we've heard about everything else are interesting and important, but not relevant to this bill. This bill is purely about discrimination, purely about protecting people from discrimination, and we all to pass it. I urge all members to support this important legislation, and I yield back the balance of my time.
All time for debate has expired. Pursuant to House Resolution 979, the previous question is ordered on the bill as amended. The question is on the amendment and on engrossment and third reading of the bill. Those in favor will say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no.
No.
The ayes have it. Third reading.
A bill to prohibit discrimination based on an individual's texture or style of hair.
The question is on passage of the bill. Those in favor will say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed will say no.
No.
The ayes have it. Purpose, does a gentleman from Ohio seek recognition?
That's for roll call.
Pursuant to Section 3S of House Resolution 8, the yeas and nays are ordered. Members will record their votes by electronic device.
The kids seek recognition.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. Madam Speaker, as the member designated by Rosa DeLauro of Connecticut and Jared Golden of Maine, I inform the House that these members will vote yes on H.R. 2116. So it's going to be that every time.
Mm-hmm. I'll just give you the state. Okay. For what purpose does the gentleman from North Carolina rise?
Madam Speaker, as a member designated by Mr. Carter of Texas, I inform the House that Mr. Carter will vote nay on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentlelady from Michigan rise?
Madam Speaker, as a member designated by the amazing Marcy Kaptur of the Midwest, I inform the House that she will vote yes on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentleman from Tennessee rise?
Madam Speaker, as the member designated by Ms. Harshbarger of Tennessee, I inform the House that Ms. Harshbarger will vote nay on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentleman from Florida seek recognition?
Thank you, Madam Speaker. As the member designated by Mr. Waltz of Florida, I inform the House that Mr. Waltz will vote nay on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentleman from New York rise?
As the member designated by Chairwoman Eddie Bernice Johnson, Chairwoman Lofgren, Representative Clark, and Representative Chantel Brown, I inform the House that these members will vote yay on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentleman from Rhode Island rise?
Madam Speaker, as the member designated by Ms. Titus of Nevada, the first state to ratify the 15th Amendment, which gave African Americans the right to vote, I inform the House that Ms. Titus will vote yes on H.R. 2116. As the member designated by Ms. Wilson of Florida, birthplace of Ariana Grande, Bob Ross, Sidney Poitier, and Pitbull, I inform the House that Ms. Wilson will vote yes on H.R. 2116. As the member designated by Mr. Larson of Connecticut, known as the Constitution State, I inform the House that Mr. Larson will vote yes on H.R. 2116. And as the member designated by Ms. Dingell of Michigan, the state which has more miles of freshwater shoreline than any other state in the nation, 3,000 to be exact, I inform the House that Ms. Dingell will vote yes on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentleman from Ohio rise?
Madam Speaker, as the member designated by Mr. Russ Fulcher of Idaho, I inform the House that Mr. Fulcher will vote nay on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentleman from Indiana rise?
Madam Speaker, as the member designated by Ms. Walorski from Indiana, I inform the House that Ms. Walorski will vote nay on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentleman from California rise?
Madam Speaker, as member designated by Hank Johnson, Henry Cuellar and John Garamendi, I inform the House that these members will vote yes on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentlelady from Florida rise?
Thank you, Madam Speaker. As the member designated by Ms. Wagner of Missouri, I inform the House that Ms. Wagner will vote nay on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentleman from Texas rise?
Madam Speaker, as a member designated by Mr. Louis Gohmert of the great state of Texas, I inform the House that Mr. Gohmert will vote nay on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentleman from California rise?
Madam Speaker, as a member designated by Mr. Calvert of California, I inform the House that Mr. Calvert will vote no on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does this gentlelady from New York rise?
Madam Speaker, as the member designated by Mr. Deutsch of Florida, I inform the House that Mr. Deutsch will vote yes on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does a gentleman from New York rise?
Madam Speaker, as the member designated by Mr. Garbarino from New York, I inform the House that Mr. Garbarino will vote nay on 2116.
When did you do it? For what purpose does the gentleman from Virginia rise?
Madam Speaker, as the member designated by Mr. Moulton of Massachusetts,
Mr. Swazi of New York, Mr. Trone of Maryland, Mr. Harder of California, Mr. DeSaunier of California, and Mr. Kind of Wisconsin, and form the House that these six members will vote yes on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentleman from Florida rise?
Thank you, Madam Speaker. As the member designated by Ms. Salazar of Florida, I inform the House that Ms. Salazar will vote nay on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentlelady from Illinois rise?
Good morning, Madam Speaker. As the member designated by Congressman Troy Carter, pursuant to H.Res. 8, I inform the House that Mr. Carter will vote yes on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentleman from Florida rise?
Madam Speaker, as the member designated by Mr. Norman of South Carolina, I inform the House that Mr. Norman will vote no on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentleman from Illinois rise?
Madam Speaker, as a member designated by Mr. Bowman of New York, I inform the House that he will vote yes on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentlelady from New York rise?
Madam Speaker, as the member designated by Mr. Van Drew of New Jersey, I inform the House that Mr. Van Drew will vote nay on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentleman from New York, from California, rise?
Madam Speaker, as the member designated by Representative Kim Schreier, I inform the House that Ms. Schreier will vote yes on House Resolution 2116.
For what purpose does the gentlelady from West Virginia rise?
Madam Speaker, as the member designated by Mr. LaHood of Illinois, I inform the House that Mr. LaHood of Illinois will vote no on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does a gentleman from Pennsylvania rise?
Madam Speaker, as a member designated for the following members, Lawson of Florida, Russ of Illinois, and Dory of Pennsylvania, they all vote yes on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentleman from Pennsylvania rise?
Madam Speaker, as a member designated by Representative Lloyd Smucker of Pennsylvania, I inform the House that Mr. Smucker will vote no on H.R. 2116. Thank you.
For what purpose does the gentleman from Colorado rise?
To say hello to the Speaker, and as the member designated by Mr. Joe Neguse of Colorado and Mr. Tim Ryan of Ohio, I inform the House that Mr. Neguse and Mr. Ryan will vote yes on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentlelady from Florida rise?
Madam Speaker, as the member designated by Mr. Crist of Florida and Ms. Maloney of New York, I inform the House that both members will vote yay on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentleman from New York rise?
Madam Speaker, as a member designated by my friend Mr. Upton from Michigan, I inform the House that Mr. Upton will vote no on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentleman from Utah rise?
Thank you, Madam Speaker. As member designated by Mr. Curtis of Utah, I inform the House that Mr. Curtis will vote nay on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentleman from Michigan rise?
Madam Speaker, as a member designated by Mr. Fortenberry of Nebraska, I inform the House that Mr. Fortenberry will vote no on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentlelady from West Virginia rise?
Madam Speaker, as the member designated by Ms. Lesko of Arizona, I inform the House that Ms. Lesko of Arizona will vote no on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentleman from Kentucky rise?
Madam Speaker, as the member designated by Mr. Barr of Kentucky, I inform the House that Mr. Barr will vote nay on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentleman from Mississippi rise?
Madam Speaker, as the member designated by Mr. LaMalfa, California, I inform the House that Mr. LaMalfa will vote nay on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentleman from Florida rise?
Madam Speaker, as the member designated by Ms. Kathy McMorris Rogers, I inform the House that Ms. Rogers will vote nay on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentlelady from Texas rise?
Madam Speaker, as the member designated by Ms. Roybal Allard, I inform the House that Ms. Roybal Allard will vote yes on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentleman from California rise?
As the member designated by Representatives Cardenas and Swalwell, I inform the House that these members will vote aye on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentleman from New Jersey rise?
Thank you, Madam Speaker. As the member designated by Mr. Albio Series, Mr. Peter Welch, Ms. Ann Kirkpatrick, Mr. Andy Kim, Mr. Bill Pascrell, Mr. Donald Payne, and Mr. Brian Higgins, I inform the House that these members will vote yes on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentleman from Texas rise?
Madam Speaker, thank you very much. As the member designated by Mr. Dan Crenshaw, Mr. Van Taylor, Mr. Madison Cawthorn, and Mr. Troy Nels, I'd like to inform the House that all four of these members will be voting nay on H.R. 2116. Thank you very much.
For what purpose does the gentlelady from Virginia rise?
Madam Speaker, as a member designated by members Connolly, Frankel, McEachin, and Porter, I inform the House that these members will vote yes on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentleman from Alabama rise?
Madam Speaker, as a member designated by Mr. Brooks, I inform the House that Mr. Brooks will vote no on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentleman from Michigan rise?
Madam Speaker, as the member designated by Mr. Kinzinger of Illinois, I inform the House that Mr. Kinzinger will vote yay on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentleman from California rise?
Madam Speaker, as the member designated by Michelle Steele of California, pursuant to House Resolution 8, I inform the House that Congresswoman Steele will vote no on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentleman from Minnesota rise?
Madam Speaker, as a member designated by Mr. Bergman of the state of Michigan, I inform the House that Mr. Bergman will vote no on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentleman from North Carolina rise?
Madam Speaker, I, as a member designated by Mr. McHenry from the great state of North Carolina, I inform the House that Mr. McHenry will vote no on the bill about hair, H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentlelady from Pennsylvania rise?
As the member designated by Ms. Dean, I inform the House that Ms. Dean will vote yes on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentlelady from California seek recognition?
Speaker, as the member designated by Representative Karen Bass, I inform the House that Representative Bass will vote yes on H.R. 2116.
I beg your pardon, sir. What purpose does the gentleman from Texas rise?
Madam Speaker, as the member designated by Ms. Van Dyne of Texas and pursuant to House Resolution 8, I inform the House that Ms. Van Dyne will vote no on H.R. 2116.
For what purpose does the gentleman from Indiana rise?
As the member designated, Mr. Kahaly, I inform the House that Mr. Kahaly will vote yay on 2116.
For what purpose does the gentlelady from Washington rise?
Madam Speaker, as a member designated by Ms. McMorris-Rogers of Washington State, I inform the House that Ms. McMorris-Rogers will vote no on H.R. 2116.
On this vote, The yeas are 235, and the nays are 189. With no one answering present, creating a respectful and open world for natural hair act is passed. Without objection, a motion to reconsider is laid on the table.
Is this the first thing I read? The House will be in order. The chair will now entertain requests for 1-minute speeches. For what purpose does a gentlewoman from Michigan seek recognition?
Madam Speaker, I ask unanimous consent to address the House for 1 minute and extend and revise my remarks.
Without objection, gentlewoman is recognized for 1 minute.
Madam Speaker, we need to protect the American people from corporate greed and abuse. The FAIR Act is one of those protections. Corporations use forced arbitration clauses to deny Americans their right to seek accountability and justice in disputes with private companies. They literally eliminated any chance a resident may have for justice from a dispute, specifically in the place of employment. From employee handbooks to bank accounts to documents to a college admission paperwork. Companies include forced arbitration clauses as the main form of dispute resolution so that they can rig the rules and appoint themselves judge and jury in the arbitration process. Forced arbitration is a private, secretive system without any enforceable standards or legal protections for our residents. There is no public disclosure of proceedings or any requirements for arbitrators to follow the law. So, Madam Speaker, forced arbitration makes it virtually impossible for anti-discrimination laws, disability rights laws, and so many other important laws to be enforced at the federal level. To put it simply, this is unjust and has failed the American public for far too long. Earlier this year, President Biden signed a law ending forced arbitration for cases involving sexual assault and sexual harassment. So I urge the Senate to pass this legislation and send it to the President's desk so that we can protect consumers and workers from corporations that seek to exploit them. Thank you, and I yield back.
Thank you. For what purpose does a gentlewoman from California seek recognition?
I rise today to address the House for 1 minute and to revise and extend my remarks.
Without objection, the gentlewoman is recognized for 1 minute.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Speaker. I rise today to honor the life of Mr. Ralph Ahn, a pioneer in the Korean-American community who exemplified the American dream. Ralph was the youngest child of Dosan Ahn Chang-ho, And Ralph joined the United States Navy and bravely served during our country fighting during the World War II. He eventually started acting, following the footsteps of his older brother, Philip Ahn, who was one of the first Asian American actors. Ralph made his film debut as a Korean prisoner in Battered Circus before taking on the roles in Mission Over Korea, Prisoner of War, The Hook, It Takes Two, The Golden Girls, and most recently as Tran on New Girl. I remember last seeing him at an event about a year ago commemorating the Korean-American pioneers and Korean independence. While I'm sad that the last generation of the Korean-American leaders have passed, I know that their legacy will continue to live on, and I offer my deepest condolences to his beautiful wife, Anne, and his family. With that, I yield back.
For what purpose does a gentlewoman from Minnesota seek recognition?
Madam Speaker, I rise today to remember Shar Knudsen, former president of the Minnesota AFL-CIO, who passed away last month. She was a bridge builder.
The gentlelady will suspend. Does the gentlelady ask for unanimous consent to address the House?
Yes, I do. Thank you for that correction, Madam Speaker.
Without objection, the gentlewoman is recognized for 1 minute.
Madam Speaker, I rise today to remember Shar Knudsen, former president of the Minnesota AFL-CIO, who passed away last month. She was a bridge builder, trailblazer, and mentor. Shar was a lifelong advocate for workers in St. Paul and across Minnesota, a trailblazer herself, the first woman to lead the Minnesota AFL-CIO. She mentored women in the labor movement and urged them to run for leadership. She was a strong booster for pro-women labor supporters seeking public office. Her early and steadfast support and encouragement was instrumental in me in helping to run for Congress and advance our common values together. Hosting Shar as my guest for President Obama's first official State of the Union address in Washington, D.C. was a privilege. Madam Speaker, please allow me to enter into the record February 22, 2022, article from the Union Advocate newspaper in St. Paul paying tribute to Shar Knudsen's life and work.
Without objection.
I'm thankful for the opportunity to work with Shar Knudsen to call her a friend. Her presence will be missed. Her legacy lives on. And with that, I yield back, Madam Speaker.
For what purpose does the gentleman from Arkansas seek recognition?
Madam Speaker, I ask unanimous consent to speak for 1 minute and revise and extend my remarks.
Without objection, the gentleman is recognized for 1 minute.
Madam Speaker, thank you. Inflation is a thief, and many of us believe that the Federal Reserve is behind the curve in fighting that thief, inflation. History is repeating itself, Madam Chair, and Jay Powell is now fighting and facing precisely what his predecessor, Arthur Burns, called the anguish of central banking in 1979. Sustained stagflation, high current inflation, growing high inflationary expectations, and now a commodity shock, these are all the problems that Chair Burns faced in the 1970s. And while I welcome the Fed's action to shrink the balance sheet and start with the 25 basis point increase in short-term rate targets, this process should have started in 2020. And in my view, they should have been more aggressive this week and supported a 50 basis increase in short-term rates. It's time for Congress.